بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. بعد، اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد، وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد، كما صليت باركت على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم، إنك حميد مجيد. Now we reached point number 63, where he continues to say, again Imam Ahmad rahimahullah is mentioning the points of belief which Ahl Sunnah they hold. وَمَنْ لَقَيَهُ مُسِرًّا غَيْرَ تَائِبٍ مِنَ الذُّنُوبِ أَلَّتِي قَدْ إِسْتَوْجَبَتْ بِهَا الْعُقُوبَ فَأَمْرُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ إِنْ شَاءَ عَذَّبَهُ وَإِنْ شَاءَ غَفَرَ لَهُ. And whoever, and meaning we believe, and we believe, whoever meets him, him should have capital H, because meets him meaning Allah. And whoever meets him, having persisted upon sin, having persisted upon sin, and not repented from the sins which necessitated punishment, then his affair is with Allah, the Mighty and Magnificent. If he wills, he will punish him, and if he wills, he will forgive him. Now this point of course is connected to the point before that, 62 also, which says whoever meets Allah and he has repented from a sin, then Allah will forgive him, because Allah accepts repentance from his lips. And 63 it says, whoever meets him having persisted upon sin, having persisted meaning not repented from the sin, from the sins which necessitate punishment, then his affair is with Allah. If he wills, meaning if Allah wills, he'll punish him. And if he wills, Allah may just forgive him without punishing him. Now there's a footnote for both of these two points. It says, in the hadith of Ubadah bin Samit, who said, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, while a small group from amongst his companions were around him, he said, Bay'uni, pledge allegiance to me, Allah tushrik billahi shay'a. We are in page 19, footnote number 26. Pledge allegiance to me that you do not associate anything with Allah, meaning you won't commit any shirk. Wa alla tusriqu, and that you do not steal. Wa alla taznu, and that you do not commit zina. Wa alla taqtulu awladakum, and that you do not kill your children. Wa alla taftari bi buhtanin, and that you do not slander, having conspired it amongst yourselves. Do not disobey in something that is good and just, he says. And whoever dies amongst you, having avoided all of that, then his reward is with Allah. And whoever falls into any of these things and is punished in the world, then that would be an expiation for him. That is the point for the previous two points. And whoever falls into any of these things, the things you just mentioned, stealing, killing, committing zina, whoever does these things, he falls into any of these things and is punished in this world by the prescribed punishment, the had, the prescribed punishment, then that would be the expiation for him. This is the proof that the had is an expiation for the sins. Meaning if someone stole and he was caught with full evidence and his hand was cut off, then that is the expiation for his sins. Meaning Allah will not punish him again for that sin in the hereafter. Allah will not question him for that sin again, because he was punished here. You understand? This is what he means. Someone killed, and so he was killed. That is the had, the prescribed punishment for someone who kills intentionally. And so he was killed. In the hereafter, that sin of killing has been expiated. Allah has forgiven him. Allah will not account him for that. And whoever falls into any of these things, and then Allah shields him, meaning Allah shielded him, Allah protected him from being known. The people not know that he stole, or he committed zina, or he killed, such that he should be killed, or such that his hand should be cut. Allah covered him, that people did not know that, then his affair will be with Allah. If he wills, he will pardon him, and if he wills, he will punish him. Ubadah said, so he pledged allegiance to him upon that. So the had, which is had, is singular, plural is hudud. Right? Is one of the most important things of establishing peace and order in a society. The prescribed punishments. There's a prescribed punishment for stealing. There's a prescribed punishment for zina. There's a prescribed punishment for slander. There's a prescribed punishment for drinking alcohol. There's a prescribed punishment for killing. Time. All of those have prescribed punishment. When someone steals, in Islamic law, his hand is to be cut. But of course, not anything. Not like when someone steals $1 or $2, no. And we don't want to go into details. That is not the point here. When someone drinks alcohol, he has to be lashed, 80 lashes. When someone kills intentionally, then he has to be killed. Okay? When someone commits zina, and this is going to come, those punishments are the expiation, the Prophet ﷺ is saying. If he's punished here, then that sin, it means it has been cleansed. Allah will not take him into account. If he was not, then his matter is with Allah. If Allah wants, he'll punish him. If he wants, he will pardon him. This is what we believe. Next he says, now why does Imam Ahmad mention this point? It is because the Khawarij and the Mu'tazila, these two deviant groups, they believe that if someone commits a major sin, killing, stealing, zina, drinking alcohol, any of the major sins, they believe that he has to be punished in the fire. There's no way Allah can just pardon him. In fact, they believe if someone continuously does those sins, he's not even a Muslim anymore. He's kafir to them. The Khawarij. That's why Imam Ahmad mentions this point. He mentions this point to show that no, we do not believe that. Because someone, Allah could forgive him. Allah could forgive him. And you mentioned the hadith of who last week? The man who killed 100 people. And after that, the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and who? Abu Dharr. And Abu Dharr, three times Abu Dharr, he asks the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what? Wa in zana wa in saraq, even if he steals, even if he kills, he says yes, even if he commits zina. Even if he's three times he asked him, he said yes. As long as he did not commit shirk. And this leads us to the next point. He says, 64, وَمَنْ لَقْيَهُ كَافِرًا عَذَّبَهُ وَلَمْ يَغْفِرْ لَهُ. He says, وَلَمْ يُغْفَرْ لَهُ. And whoever meets him as a disbeliever, meaning whoever dies and goes and meets Allah as a disbeliever, having committed kufr and shirk, then he will punish him and he'll not forgive him. He'll punish him and he'll not forgive him. Why? Why do we say that? Because we have footnote number 27 there. It says, Allah says, this is the translation of the meaning in Surah An-Nisa, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَن يَشَاءُ. Surely Allah does not forgive that anything should be associated with him, shirk. Allah does not forgive shirk. وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ. And he forgives though what is besides that, anything lesser than shirk. Anything lesser than shirk. And whoever's going to translate this ayah, that translation is not right. You should say, and he forgives what is lesser than that. That is the right translation. That is the word Allah used. وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ. Allah forgives what is less than shirk, killing, stealing, as long as you do not declare it to be halal, of course. That is another thing. So Allah does not forgive that anything should be associated with him. Allah will not forgive shirk. If someone dies upon shirk, of course. But if someone repented, then Allah accepts all the repentance in this life. Like someone, he was Christian, then he became Muslim. Yeah, he left shirk. Does Allah accept it or not? Of course he accepts it. Right? But now we're talking about someone dying upon that state. If someone dies upon that state, Allah does not forgive him. And he forgives what is lower than that, what is lower than shirk, to whoever he wants. Whoever he wants. So no one has a guarantee. That's why we say, if he wills, he'll punish him. If he wills, he'll forgive him. And he also says, إِنَّهُ مَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ الْجَنَّةَ مَأْوَاهُ النَّارُ وَمَا لِلظَّالِمِينَ مِنْ أَنْصَارِ. Surely, whoever associates others with Allah, whoever commits shirk, then Allah has forbidden to him the garden, meaning paradise. Whoever dies upon shirk, Allah has forbidden for him paradise. Like we said last week, he will end up in the hellfire forever. But the believer who had tawheed, he did not commit shirk. Maybe he stole, maybe he killed. One day he is going to be taken out of the hellfire. But the one who died upon shirk, Allah says he has made, he has forbidden for him the garden, paradise. He will never enter paradise. He will stay there in forever in the hellfire. And his abode is the fire, and there shall be no helpers for the unjust. It means that whoever dies as a polytheist is someone who has more than one god, polytheist. And someone who just takes one god is what? Monotheist. Allah will never forgive him, and his eternal place is hell. The polytheist. And also the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, whoever dies while he associates partners with Allah, he shall enter the hellfire. And whoever dies and he does not associate partners with Allah, he shall enter paradise. Meaning, even if he's to be punished first because of the sins he does, one day he'll end up in paradise. And this again leads us to remind each other the importance of learning Tawheed and learning about shirk. Because you know, you have to know shirk to avoid it. It's not just a term which you avoid, shirk, that's it, no. Shirk has different forms, statements. Some statements are shirk or kufr. Some actions, some beliefs in the heart, they negate the Tawheed which you have. They negate that. Taib? You have to learn about shirk. You have to learn about tawheed. So that one day you know I have hope. One day I have hope. Because it doesn't matter. You could be praying salah. You could be fasting. You could be giving charity. But you're not a Muslim. Because of some of the beliefs you have in your heart. If you believe Mirza Ghulam Qadiani was another prophet, after Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it doesn't matter if you pray 10 million times a day, not 5 times. Pray 10 million times a day. That prayer does not help you. That charity you do doesn't help you. If you believe the Aga Khan and his forefathers, they are representation of God on this earth, it doesn't help you if you go for Hajj. It doesn't help you if you donate $2 million for Muslims. He won't help you anything. Allah will give you good in this world. Whoever does good in this world, Allah gives him good. Even the kafir, even the Jew, even the one who worships shaitan. The Prophet Sami said, anybody who does good to other people, Allah repays him in this world. But the one who is a Muslim, Allah repays him in this world and the hereafter. So learning Tawheed is very important. Because there's some things which contradict the basic beliefs of Islam. And it is sad that many Muslims in Muslim lands, they don't understand that. Many Muslims are involved in magic. Either they do magic or they go to someone for magic to be done on them or for them. That completely contradicts the Tawheed, which is very important for you to be a Muslim. Because magic is clearly kufr. Allah says, وَلَقَدْ عَلِمُوا لَمَنْ اشْتَرَاهُ مَا لَهُ فِي الْآخَرَةِ مِنْ خَلَاقٍ. And he has known, the one who takes magic, in the hereafter he has nothing. Allah says learning it is kufr. Now imagine practicing it. وَمَا كَفَرَ سُلَيْمَانُ وَلَكِنَّ الشَّيَاطِينَ كَفَرُ يَعْلِّمُونَ النَّاسَ السِّحْرَ. He said Sulaiman never practiced magic. Prophet Sulaiman never practiced magic. But the devils, they committed kufr because they taught people. Imagine if they are teaching people, that is kufr. What about practicing it? How many Muslims we know they do magic? Imagine. How many Muslims he goes to the grave of his grandfather or of his peer and his sheikh and he calls on him like he's alive. Help me, save me. Dua, which, can we please close that door? Dua which should be done to Allah, they directed to fellow human beings. It's completely against Tawheed. So it's very important to learn about Tawheed and to learn about Shirk so you can avoid it. So this is our belief. This is our belief. Next, to move on, number 65, he says, الرجم حق على من زنى وقد أحسن إذا اعترف أو قامت عليه بينة. وقد رجم رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وقد رجم الأئمة الرشيدون. He says, 65 and 66, they come together. الرجم حق على من زنى وقد أحسن إذا اعترف أو قامت عليه بينة. And الرجم, stoning to death, it is true and correct. It is the rightful due of the one who has fortified himself or herself with marriage, and then he commits or she commits zina, illegal sexual intercourse, either when he or she confesses to that act, or when the evidence is established against him or her. The punishment is for him or her to be stoned to death. This is someone who has been previously married. Anyone who has been married or is still married in a marriage, and then he or she commits zina, then his punishment is to be stoned. When he or she confesses himself, or the evidence is established against him or her. He said, and the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he stoned to death, he practiced this. And the rightly guided leaders too, they stoned to death, Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, and the rest. And the rest. Now, he says here the footnote. Who's going to help in reading? Read. Footnote 28, page 20, footnote number 28 on this issue of stoning. He says, throughout the history of religions, zina has been prohibited. There's no religion which came with allowing zina, except those crazy cults, which some of them still exist. However, its prohibition is more emphatic and forceful, and is regarded as one of the greatest sins of all the major sins in Islam. If you go to the Bible, which they have today still, the book of Leviticus, you'll find that whoever commits zina is to be stoned. The Bible they read today is still there. The book of Leviticus, they have it there. Yes. If someone performs it voluntarily and deliberately, so if someone was forced, then that is not considered zina for him or for her. If someone was forced or coerced, yes. was used. Now why are we mentioning all this? It's very important. Because number one, there's people who came and said, no, if you are to wear a condom, then that is not considered zina. Because zina in Islamic law, what is the definition? It's when the male private part is inserted into the female private part. That is zina. So they said if you actually to wear a condom or a separate or anything, it means the two private parts did not meet. So that is not zina, which is an opinion, of course, which everyone knows is wrong. Everyone knows it's wrong. And this is the definition of zina in Islam. Of course, there's different types of zina. The Prophet ﷺ said what? The zina of the eyes, the zina of the hands, the zina of the tongue. But the zina which entails that you be stoned if you're married before, is the zina when the actual two parts meet. That's why it has to be defined like that, because it's very important. You just don't take anyone who they were holding hands and you said, no, they have to be stoned. No. It's very important to know the definitions. Yes. Proving zina. Number one, how is it enforced? How is it someone convicted of it? If someone confesses, someone comes out himself and says, I did it. Then, in an Islamic land, Islamic law, where you have the Islamic leader who we discussed this, he's the one who appoints someone to establish the had, the punishment. Not just anyone does that. Then he can be punished. But if at any time this person here retracts, he says, no, actually I did not do it, then he's not to be punished until some evidence is actually established. And this shows you the mercy of Islam. It's not just, okay, someone confessed right away, take him, kill him. No, that's not the point. That is not the point. Yes. If at some stage, the second way is for four witnesses to confirm that. Four people, they saw them actually doing the act. Not just they saw them, we saw them sitting together. That is not enough. Four people saw them doing the act, then the punishment is established. Someone may ask, why four? Where are you going to get four people? This is how much Islam. This shows that Islam, the goal is not what? Just to shed blood. That is not the goal. That is someone's life. And this is someone who's married. He has a family. So there has to be no doubt left. There has to be no doubt left. Four people have to see that. Like we said, there's order for everything. There's discipline. Yes. This stringent condition.
This stringent condition is to protect innocent Muslims and to block the road for those who want evil to spread amongst the Muslim society.
To block the road for those who want evil to spread. Because someone, if I have some hatred against you, I can just go to the leader, to the ruler, and say, you know what? I saw him committing zina. If one person's witness was enough, then I'm in trouble, right or wrong. Or if two people, you can get second person to agree with you in whatever you want to do. But for you to get three other people who are going to lie with you, that is difficult. That is difficult. Naam.
As for the third way, a person may be convicted of adultery. This is when a woman who has neither husband nor master is found pregnant.
Number three, if a woman who is not married, she becomes pregnant. It just does not happen out of thin air. She got it somewhere. Then she can be convicted of zina. She has never been married. She never had a husband. Now that is how it is proven. Once it's proven, now comes the punishment. The offender must be sane. If the person, the convicted person, is someone who's in sin, he has no idea what he's doing, he's not to be stoned. They have reached the age of puberty, old enough to be responsible for their actions, yes. They must be free when they had free people and the slaves. The slave is not stoned. A slave is not to be stoned. The free man is stoned. And read. The next page, 21. You don't have the page. You have it? Yeah, read. No. You don't have the page also. You don't have the page. Armin, you have the page? Okay, read, please. The Quranic injunctions, the commands of Islam about zina, prohibiting zina, they came gradually, bit by bit. Why? Because the society which the Prophet was sent to and the new Muslims were converting to this new religion, Islam, they were deeply, deeply engaged in zina. The Arabs, they were lost in zina. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He knows what is best for human beings. He sent the injunctions gradually. Yes. The first injunction was that if a woman is caught, again, if it's proven by those three ways that she committed zina, then her punishment was that she had to stay in her house until she dies. She never leaves the house. She never leaves the house. Now, this is Surah An-Nisa. The second revelation is for both men and women. Allah says, also again in Surah An-Nisa, yes. Then Allah revealed the beginning of Suratul Nur. See Suratul Nur. Allah says the woman and the man who are guilty of illegal sexual intercourse, zina, flog each of them with 100 stripes. Should lash them 100 lashes. And let not pity withhold you in the case, in a punishment prescribed by Allah, if you really believe in Allah in the last day. This is what they deserve, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. And we know the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said what? When one day the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sitting with the Sahaba after a battle, and there was a woman who was looking in a frenzy. She was looking for her child. Then she found that small, small baby. She took the baby and put her close to her chest. And the Prophet asked the Sahaba, do you think this woman could ever kill that baby, that daughter, child of hers? He said, never, Ya Rasulullah. How can a mother kill his own baby? He said, then Allah is more merciful to you than that mother to the baby. Allah is more merciful to you human beings than that mother to the baby. Allah, whatever Allah has prescribed, you should know that is what is best for human beings. Who created you in the first place? It is Allah. He knows what is best for you. So Allah says, when people are proven they are guilty of this act, then establish that punishment on them. And let not any pity come to your hearts if you are true believers. If you are true believers. This is the mercy they deserve. This is the mercy they deserve. Sometimes it has to be strict. It has to be strict, yes. The mercy of Allah, then he clarified this injunction. He said, There's two groups. People who are not married and people who are married. If someone who hasn't been married, he has never been married, and is not married in the current time, he commits zina, his punishment is to be lashed 100 lashes. 100 lashes. And to be banished from the land where he lives for 1 year. He has to leave that land for 1 year. He is to be exiled for 1 year. That is for people who are not married. For those who are married, their punishment is to be stoned. Yes. The scholars, they differ. The 100 lashes for both the male and the female who is not married. But the exiling, is the woman also exiled? They said the woman, some of the scholars, they said no, because the woman is weak. Type. Now, maybe we stop. Why does Islam say they should be exiled for a year? It's because zina is a very bad disease. And these people are sick. They have been punished, but they have to be put away for them to reform themselves so that disease does not spread to other people. He doesn't go and do it to someone else, and she doesn't go and starts doing it to someone else, and then it spreads. It is a form of punishment. Imagine being away from your family for 1 year. Not by choice. Not by choice. It's because you're forced. You're banned from this country for 1 year. And you're under watch. Of course, all of this again is to, we're talking about in Islamic government, Islamic state. You're under watch. The government is watching. This person is being exiled because of this sin he committed. It is a way of reformation. It is a way of reforming that person. Such that after that 1 year, he becomes a better person. He becomes a better person. And the 100 lashes, most people, when you hear 100 lashes, those images from TV you've been watching a lot, they come to your mind. Someone is pegged to the bark of a tree, and someone is raising his hand all the way and swinging his hand. That's one. Then he goes 100. No, it's not like that. It's not like that. Again, the goal is not to kill him. The goal is not to shed his blood. No. The goal is just to give him a punishment for him to realize he's done something bad. The goal is not enforce as much pain as you can on him through 100 lashes. That's not the goal. And that's not how it's done anyway. That's not how it's done. Naam. The Prophet ﷺ, he applied the stoning to a number of people during his time. From them is Ma'iz ibn Malik, radiallahu anhu, this great Sahabi. He fell into a mistake. Yes. As per collected by Bukhari and Muslim and others. Ma'iz, he was sincere though. He fell into the mistake of zina. And he came by himself to the Prophet ﷺ. And he said, Ya Rasulullah, I committed zina. And the Prophet ﷺ looked at his sahaba. He said, Is he crazy? He said, No, Rasulullah, I'm not crazy. I committed zina. He said, Maybe you just played with her. He said, No. My part went into her part. And the Prophet asked him questions and questions until he stood there. He said, I committed it. He said, Tahirni, purify me. Then the Prophet tried as much as he can to push him away. And this is the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, he said, try as much as you can to give excuses to the people. Udra'ul hududa, ayyo bishubuhat. There has to be complete clarification. There's no doubt that he really committed this. That's what he said. If he confessed, then he went back. He said, no, actually, I didn't do it. He's not to be punished. But Ma'iz, he gave himself like that. And the other one, the woman from Hamidiyah, Naam. The Hamidiyah, the woman from Hamid tribe. She also came herself to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And she said, Ya Rasulullah, I committed zina. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked him again those questions. He said, No. And I'm pregnant. So the Prophet ﷺ said to him, go until you give birth. Then you come back. The goal is not to shed blood. If this was a barbaric religion, the Prophet ﷺ would just stone her and do away with it. Especially she's carrying a child who's not legitimate, right? He said, no, go until you give birth, then you come back. When she came back, the Prophet ﷺ said what? Go and you breastfeed the child until it reaches the age where it can eat by itself. And she went, how many years are those? At least 2 years. Then she came back and the child was holding a piece of bread for himself. And the Prophet ﷺ assigned someone to take care of the child and she was stoned. Imagine, even after 2 years, she did not recant her statement. Why? Because they knew, if you get punished in this world, that is the purification. You rather get stoned here and not get the hellfire of Jahannam. That is how strong their iman was. Yes. We know that the punishment, that had of stoning, is an atonement for that sin, like we went through last week. When that punishment is established on you, it means that sin has been wiped away from you now. Naam. The Prophet Sami said, she has repented, a repentance that which, if were to be divided among 70 of Medina's residents, it will cover them all. Don't you see? Have you seen a better repentance than someone who gave herself to Allah? Naam. This idea, it does not contradict with the spirit of Islam. Islam is about rahmah. This is rahmah. This is mercy. Why? Because this serves as a deterrent for other people who wants to commit that same sin. It protects a person's family. If your husband or your wife went out and committed zina, that child is not your child. Now you're corrupting everything in the family, the lineage, the spread of moral decadence. Anyone who commits zina is a liar. They go together. They go together. And most of the time there's drugs involved and diseases in the society, HIV and all these other diseases. So that punishment, when someone knows that there's this punishment, you think many people would go into zina, or many people would stay away from it. They'll stay away. That is why you see the places where this punishment is prescribed, the rate of zina is really, really low, minimal. Minimal. And the lands where there's nothing like that, where people, they commit zina like animals, you see the society is crumpled. Crumpled. Naam. When someone, he realizes the graveness of this sin and the punishment is so humiliating and painful, it serves as a deterrent. Someone will not want to commit that sin. Like stealing. Someone knows if I get caught stealing, my hand will be chopped off. That means I have no hand to use. And it's not the whole hand which is chopped off, it's from the wrist. And that is one of the importances of following the sunnah. There's some people who don't know or who don't want to follow the sunnah. They took someone's hand and they cut it from the elbow. The khawarij. They cut it from the elbow. That's not what the Prophet said. That's not what he did. Now that serves as a deterrent for anyone else. And also for someone who wants to do it. Because you know this will stay for me forever. Everyone will see me after that act. Everyone will see my hand is chopped. They will know that once I stole. Who wants that humiliation with him? Islam came to prevent those acts by these obstacles. These are deterrents. These are deterrents. Naam. And that's it. Next, point number 67 will be after the adhan and Salatul Isha, inshaAllah. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك اشهد ان لا اله الا انت استغفرك واتوب اليك. I see you're looking at me. واشهد ان محمدا عبده ورسوله بعد. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى ال محمد وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت باركت على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. Next he says, point number 67, which somehow we already covered when we were speaking about the Sahaba. ومن انتقص أحدا من أصحاب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أو أبغضه لحدث كان منه أو ذكر مساوئه كان مبتدعا حتى يترحم عليهم جميعا ويكون قلبه لهم سليما حتى يترحم عليهم جميعا ويكون قلبه لهم سليما. That is 68. He says, and whoever disparages, meaning talks badly, to disparage is to talk negatively, and degrades a single one of the companions of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or dislikes him on account of something that occurred from him, or mentions his shortcomings, then he is a mubtada', an innovator. Then he is an innovator. He says, 68, he remains as such until he asks for Allah's mercy, rahmah for them, all of them, and until his heart is salim, sincere and free of evil towards them. And whoever, now there's about four things here. وَمَنْ اِنْتَقَصَ أَحَدًا مِنْ أَصْحَابِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. And whoever disparages any of the companions of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, أَوْ أَبْغَضَهُ لِحَدَثٍ كَانَ مِنْهُ, or degrades one of them, or he dislikes him on account of something which he did. أو ذكر مساوئه, or he mentions his shortcomings. Meaning this person, he makes his job is just to mention the shortcomings of this Sahaba. كان مبتدعا, then he is a مبتدع, an innovator. He is someone who has left the group of Ahl Sunnah. This is something which Imam Ahmad mentioned before. He is mentioning it again because of its very importance. It is one of the main distinctions between the people of the Sunnah and the people who are not following the Sunnah. That our hearts are clean for all the Sahaba. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentioned in Suratul, don't tell me the ayah, tell me the surah first. You mentioned that here several times. Suratul Hashr, mashaAllah. Ayah number, what's the verse number? 10. It starts from 8. The context starts from 8. للفقراء المهاجرين الذين أخرجوا من ديارهم وأموالهم يبتغون فضلا من الله رضوانا ينصرون الله رسوله أولئك هم الصادقون. Allah says, the فقراء of the مهاجرون, the مهاجرون are those who they left, migrated from Mecca going to Medina. Allah says, the poor ones from the مهاجرون who were kicked out of their own lands, leaving the land and their property. Why? Because they were seeking Allah's pleasure and His bounties. And why? Because they were aiding Allah and His messenger. They were giving victory to this deen. They had to migrate. Allah says, those are the truthful ones. Those are the truthful believers. So if Allah says they are truthful, who are you to have anything against them? Who are you to disparage them or to degrade them? Allah, He praises them. They are the truthful believers. أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الصَّادِقُونَ. They left everything. Then Allah mentioned the second group. وَالَّذِينَ تَبَوَّأُوا الدَّارَ وَالْإِيمَانَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ يُحِبُّونَ مَنْ هَاجَرَ إِلَيْهِمْ وَلَا يَجِدُونَ فِي صُدُورِهِمْ حَاجَةً مِمَّا أُوتُوا وَيُؤْثِرُونَ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ وَلَوْ كَانَ بِهِمْ خَصَاصَةٌ وَمَنْ يُوقَ شُحَّ نَفْسِهِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. Allah says in the second group, وَالَّذِينَ تَبَوَّأُوا الدَّارَ وَالْإِيمَانَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ, and those who prepared their land, for those ones who are migrating. They migrated from Mecca going to Medina. These people of Medina now prepared the land for those brothers who are coming. And before that, they had prepared Iman in their hearts. They love the brothers who migrated to them. يُحِبُّونَ مَنْ هَاجَرَ إِلَيْهِمْ. They did not have any bad feelings about, why did these people come here? You know why? Allah says, وَلَا يَجِدُونَ فِي صُدُورِهِمْ حَاجَةً مِمَّا أُوتُوا. And whatever they gave, in fact, to them, they did not have anything in their hearts. Even though they themselves, they deserved it more. They themselves are poor. وَلَوْ كَانَ بِهِمْ خَصَاصٌ. They themselves, they deserve to be given, but they gave to them. Allah says, وَمَنْ يُوقَ شُحَّ نَفْسِهِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. And the one who will be like those, he is saved from his own soul's stinginess. You are saved from your own stinginess. You give preference to others. He says, those are the successful ones. So the first group are the truthful ones. Allah praised them. The second group, the Ansar, people of Medina, who prepared the land. Allah says those are the successful ones. So if Allah says they are successful, who are you to have any bad feelings about them? Who are you to disparage them and to talk badly about them? Allah knew they are human beings, right or wrong. Allah created them. Allah knew what they are going to do. Maybe some of them will fall into mistakes. Yes. Yet at the same time, He praised them so much. Then Allah mentions the third group now, me and you. وَالَّذِينَ جَاءُوا مِنْ بَعْدِهِمْ and those who came after them, after the Muhajirun and the Ansar, and those who came after them. What is about them? يَقُولُونَ They are ones who say what? They make this dua, رَبَّنَا اغْفِرْ لَنَا O Allah forgive us, وَلِإِخْوَانِنَا الَّذِينَ سَبَقُونَ بِالْإِيمَانِ And forgive our brothers who have preceded us in faith, those Muslims before us, the Sahaba. So you make dua for yourself and make dua for them. So not only is your heart clean, it's more than that. You actually even make dua for them. So you could have no grudges against someone. You have nothing wrong. But that does not mean you're someone, he's special to you. It does not mean he's special to you. But if someone you make dua for him, that Allah forgives and makes him better, then that person is special. It really shows that in your heart, there's nothing against it. So Allah says, so those who come after them, they say, making this dua, oh Allah, forgive us and those brothers of ours who preceded us in faith. Then Allah says what? وَلَا تَجْعَلْ فِي قُلُوبِنَا غِلًّا لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا Not only dua for forgiveness, and do not make in our hearts any hard feelings against those who believed. رَبَّنَا إِنَّكَ رَأُوفُ الرَّحِيمُ You are the most kind, the most merciful. Those are the three groups of believers. So if you find someone who actually talks bad about the Sahaba or curses them and does not make dua for them, then you know this person has problems, major problems. And he cannot be a person who's properly guided on the right path. That's why Imam Ahmad says, he says, in fact, you'll find that person, he is not a person of the Sunnah, he is a mubtadi', an innovator. Someone who has strayed from the Sunnah. He's on another path. He says, and you'll continue to be like that, he shall continue to be like that until he revokes and he recants that statement and he asks Allah for Allah's mercy for them. All of them, not just that one Sahaba, all of them. And his heart is salim. His heart is sincere and free of evil towards them. Then you'll not be considered a person of innovation, you'll be considered a person who's come back to the Sunnah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said what? Man sabba ashabi fa'alayhi la'anatullahi wa malaikat wa nas ajma'in. Waliyadhan billah. Whoever curses my companions, whoever slanders them, upon him is the curse of Allah and the angels and all of humanity. And he said, وَإِذَا ذُكِرَ أَصْحَابِ فَأَمْسِكُوا When you hear people starting to talk bad about my Sahaba, keep quiet. Do not indulge in that. Do not indulge in that. Why? Because Allah, he praised these people. Allah says, I'm pleased with them. If Allah is pleased with them, who are you to come and talk bad about them? Allah mentions so many ayahs. لَقَدْ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذْ يُبَايِعُونَكَ تَحْتَ الشَّجَرَ فَعَلِمَ مَا فِي قُلُوبِهِ فَأَنزَلَ السَّكِينَةَ عَلَيْهِمْ وَأَثَابَهُمْ فَتْحًا قَرِيبًا Allah is pleased with those who gave you the bay'ah, pledge of allegiance under the tree. We said, how many people are there? 1,400 men and women. Allah said, I'm pleased with them. And I knew what was in their hearts. They were not just acting. They were not just showing off. I know what is in their hearts. That's why I'm pleased with them. And I sent down the tranquility for them. And I gave them a promise of a near victory. If Allah is pleased with them, what is our duty? Our duty is to be pleased with them. Didn't Allah know, I'm saying this again. Didn't Allah know that sometime they're going to fall into mistakes? Of course. They're human. But like we said before, their mistakes compared to the good things they have done for themselves and for Islam, it's like what? It's like taking a coin and throwing it into the Pacific Ocean. That is the Sahaba. That is the Sahaba. They were not infallible. They were not angels or prophets, meaning they were They did not make mistakes. No, they made mistakes. Like you see, Maiz, he committed zina, but he's going to Jannah. the Ghamidiyya, the woman from the Ghamid tribe. Prophet Sami says she has repented a repentance which is enough for 70 people. These are the ones Allah said is praised with. He has praised them and is pleased with them. He knew some of them are going to make mistakes because they're human beings. But the mistakes they make, they are no way compared to the great actions they have done. And you never know. Maybe it's like the case of Ma'iz and the Ghamidiyya. Maybe they repented from that mistake. So why do you criticize a Sahaba for this or that? You never know, maybe he repented. And someone who repents is not to be criticized. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet said, At-ta'ib min al-dhambi, the one who repents from a sin is like one who never did it. So who gave you the job to come and start to talk about Ali and talk about Muawiyah and talk about Az-Zubayr or Talha or Al-Hassan or Hussein or Aisha, Abu Bakr? Who are you? Who gave you that job? Why don't you look at yourself and your family first? Simple logic. This is one of the foundations of Islam. Okay, we have to stop here today. And we continue tomorrow, inshallah. Now, if you have any questions, you can ask. Yes. How can you be biased? If you're biased, it means you're not saying the truth. Are you pointing specifically to this point? If you are mentioning history that is not considered, you're talking bad about them. That comes down to your ear. You're mentioning what happened. This is what happened between them. You're just mentioning what happened. But at the same time, you're saying, we love all of them. And you make dua for all of them. And we know all of them are pleased. Allah is pleased by them. And you know all of them are going to Jannah. That's different. It's different than someone who mentions that story because of a hidden agenda he has to point someone and to speak bad about someone. Same story, two different agendas or two different intentions. Like we mentioned Ma'iz, he committed zina. We didn't mention it to discredit him and to disparage him, no. We mention him as an example in this case. And at the same time, when you mention him, say, radiallahu anhu, may Allah be pleased with him. And we know for sure he's in Jannah, because he was one of the Sahaba of the Prophet, and he repented from that sin. This is different than someone who from the Shia will come and say, oh, you see, so these were from his companions. Or someone from the Christian or Jews wants to speak bad about Islam. He say, oh, you see, Muhammad's companions, they are fornicators. Same story. He's using it in two different. Now he is biased. You understand me? Good. One of my sisters is very ill, so I make dua for her when I finish my wudu, considering this time as a special moment for granting dua. Am I right? As I read in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made dua by raising his hands after wudu. There's no hadith where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made dua after wudu. There's no hadith that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made dua after wudu by raising his hands. There's no hadith like that. The best time to make, you should have the book. If you don't have the book of dua, then you'll get it soon. But anyways, some of the best times to make dua is when? Between adhan and iqama. Between adhan and iqama. The adhan of dhuhr until the iqama of dhuhr, that 10-15 minutes. Or adhan of fajr to iqama of fajr. Adhan of any salah, those five salahs. That is the time dua is not rejected. Another time is in sujood, while praying. Any salah, whether it is fard or nafil. In sujood, after saying Subhana Rabbil A'la, then you make dua. Another time, when it's raining, you make dua. Another time, when you're a traveler, or when you're fasting, when you're breaking your fast, those are times when dua is not rejected. in the last third of the night, an hour, 2 hours before Fajr. Can you please live broadcast the Bukhari Hadith class, as many families like to listen to this from home? And also, should I bring Bukhari Hadith with me when I am attending the class, and which one? Yes, yes, yes. Right? Okay, you don't like that way. Yes, we can broadcast, but I'm not involved with the broadcast, so I have to ask the brothers who do that. Number two, yes, you should bring your book. Actually, the answer to the third one is not yes. It does not apply. Which one? Any Sahih Bukhari, the best is the one by Darussalam. Volume number one, we started from the beginning. Volume number one. Arabic and English should be preferred. And then since we are finishing this class, as you see, maybe we are finishing tomorrow. So that Bukhari class, especially for those who missed it, before we did that in, when? No, it's not last year. I was not here last year. It's not last year. That was April. If you miss that, then you can come. We'll be doing that Tuesdays and Wednesdays, because this class is finishing, maybe tomorrow. So the Bukhari, Kitabul Iman, which is good for you guys. It's a continuation of Aqidah, basically. Kitabul Iman is about Aqidah and Bukhari. It's a good one for you guys. You should come. You bring a copy of Sahih Bukhari with you too, whether it is soft or hard copy. You can just download it on your iPad or your iPhone or Android, whatever you use, so you don't feel bad, the Android guys. English and Arabic, though, preferred. Can you please tell me the number of the hadith and recorded by whom for the following two? If you cannot tell me now, please email me the information, as I need this. Okay. The hadith saying the Prophet ﷺ gave 400 to 1,000 as mahar for his wives, as said by you. We say the Prophet ﷺ, he gave how much for mahar? None of you are here, though. You are here. Yeah, what did I say? In dirhams. No. The hadith itself. Anyway, we say if you convert whatever he gave to today's money, it comes to around this, 300 to 400. The hadith where the Prophet ﷺ asks Ali to give his arm as mahar. Okay, I will email to you, inshallah. Is a divorced woman equivalent to a widow in terms if she is allowed to go out? If not, what should she do if she did? If a woman is divorced, she is in a'idda, the waiting period, which is how long? We have 3 months, we have 4 months. Any more answers? 4 months and 10 days. Another one? 3 answers as of now. Which one? Well, if a divorced woman, how long she stays? Thalathat quru. What is quru? Menstrual period. She waits until she gets 3 menstruations, basically. When she gets clean. If she gets clean after the third one, now she's not married anymore. If her husband did not take her back, okay, she has finished the iddah, the waiting period. She's not divorced anymore. She's a free woman, if you can call it like that. Of course, like you said, if she's not pregnant, if she was divorced while she's pregnant, then the iddah, the waiting period, ends whenever she gives birth. If she gave birth after 1 day, then after that 1 day, now she doesn't have to wait 3 months. Okay, but anyway, a woman, when she's divorced, she stays in the house of her husband. The same house, the marital home, we should call it that. A woman, when divorced, this is a major mistake which happens, that's why I'm mentioning it. does not go out back to her family. I want to go home. Say, go. I don't want to see you again. That's what happens, right? In fact, I'll pack for you your bags. That's what happens. It's not supposed to be like that. We say it here, even if you divorce in a good way, right? You don't have to fight that bad. You divorce, you get married in a good way, you divorce in a good way. Now, let me finish, Akhi. Are you getting married soon? You divorcing anyone soon? No, don't divorce anyone. Anyway, the woman is supposed to stay in the same house with her husband for those 3 months. Or if she's pregnant, until she gives birth. Okay? In the same house. Why does Islam prescribe that? So that there should be a chance that they get back to each other. They resolve their problems. She should not leave. Number two, is she allowed to go out of the house if there's a necessity? She has a doctor's appointment. Then she has a doctor's appointment. There's no one to do her groceries for her, let's say. Then she goes to do the groceries. That is okay. That is okay. But she does not go out just for the sake of going out. No. Taib? Just like the divorced woman is same. If the divorced, sorry, the widowed one. If she has no one now, she's widowed. The husband passed away. She has no other family. She has to work. She has to go to work. She's a teacher somewhere. She teaches Quran. She has to go. She has to go teach. She needs to go pick up her children from school. She needs to go pick up the children. Taib? She goes out of necessity. That is okay. What were you saying? That is the talaq which is raj'i. The first talaq and the second talaq. If it's the third talaq, meaning you have divorced your wife 3 times now, then the third one, she does not stay in the house because there's no way of you taking her back. She has to leave. She leaves the house and goes to her family. The third one. That is in the third one. Yes. What if she happened to go out? What should she do? There's nothing she should do. She just has to know that now. There's nothing she should do. You have any more questions? Yes. Sure, you should do da'wah to her, yes. She's not a Muslim. The du'a you make for is for Allah to guide her. That's the best du'a you can make for her. That Allah guides her to Islam. That's the best du'a she needs. I thought you were talking about a Muslim. The best du'a is for Allah to guide her to Islam. Yes. Yes. Are we going to have an exam? Yes. We are going to have the exam. How many points have we covered? How many points has Imam Ahmad mentioned? 67. I will ask you to write 50 points. What do Ahlul Sunnah hold as the Aqidah? I'm giving you away the exam. That is the exam. Seriously. What do we hold as our Aqidah? As you see, some points he's like a repetition. He mentioned the Sahaba before, now he's mentioned again. I'll give you a paper for you to fill up 50 points. What do Ahlul Sunnah believe? When? That's what you're asking me. Next week. On Thursday. Not next Thursday, not tomorrow. Coming Thursday. Which will be what? 12th. Very good. Yeah. No. English only. English. Word for word? No. In fact, if you write word for word, I'll be bored. Because I'll be reading the same thing. I told you this, if not you, then others. I always tell this to students. The main point is for you to understand. This is not the Quran. The Quran you have to memorize exactly the same. But anything else, you understand. Once you understand, you can write in your own way. As long as the point is the same. As long as you're speaking the same thing, that is what is enough. If you mention proof, you get bonus marks. Yeah, if you mention proofs, it tells me that you really understood. Yes. 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 Now you're getting scared, all of you. Yes. Yeah. نفس الشيء. لو هي تحتاج تشتغل تروح للمدرسة لو ما عندها أحد. ممكن الزوج يكون مريض. أيوة مطلق. كيف تعيش بوحدها هي وهي متزوجة؟ المرأة إذا الحكم الشرعي اسمعي الحكم الشرعي المرأة إذا طلقت تبقي في بيت زوجها لمدة العدة والزوج يتكفل بكل شيء حتى تنتهي العدة. أيوه إذا احتاجت أن تخرج من البيت تخرج من البيت، هذه ضرورة، بس هي تبقي في العدة، هي ما تتزوج بمدة العدة. العدة اسمعي، العدة مش لازم أنت تبقي في البيت وتغلق الأبواب، لا هذا مش معنى العدة. العدة أنت تبقي بثلاثة أشهر ما تتزوج، فهمت؟ ثلاثة أشهر إسلامية. By the way, three Islamic months we said